Hello everyone, I hope you had a wonderful whatever reason you didn't work and ate a lot of food and slept a lot. I'm not dead, so yay on that. So my most popular video on YouTube, apart from my guinea pigs dancing to the Harlem Shake, I guess you should say the most popular video that I actually put effort into and appeared in, is my top 5 books of all time. So apparently people like that. So we're gonna do a top 5 books that I read this year. Yay! This year I decided to keep a list of all the books that I read, just for fun. I don't know. I wrote it down when I finished the book, so I have a list. This year was a very bad year for reading. I only read 51 books. I'm sorry. I can make an excuse, but the truth is that I just didn't read a lot. Whenever I had free time, I found myself watching a movie or something, so. Truth bomb. Still, with 51 books, I figured I could pull some good stuff out of there. For this list, any book that is on my top 5 of all time is not included because I did reread Harry Potter and the Aborson trilogy. They're just as good as they used to be. And I had really forgotten how good the Aborson trilogy is. That's a good series. If you haven't read it, you need to read it. Before I get started, I'm gonna do a quick honorable mention because there's just some stuff I wanna talk about, but they didn't really make the list. So yeah, the honorable mention stuff. First one is the Genghis series by Conan Golden. His Emperor series made the list last year, which is about Julius Caesar. Historical fiction, heavy emphasis on the fiction. Really good series, I love the Emperor series. And this one is about Genghis Khan. Now the reason this isn't gonna make the list is because the first 3 books in the series are awesome. They're just as good as the Emperor series. I loved them to death. But then Genghis died because, you know, he ended up dying. He's not still alive out there, I hope. But anyways, Genghis died and the series kept going on with Ogde Khan and Monk Khan and finally Kublai Khan. And the thing is that historical period in Mongol history really isn't that, I'm gonna be blunt, it wasn't that interesting. All they did was conquer everything. There wasn't really any setting up a new empire and somebody rising from anything. It was just pretty straightforward. They just conquered everything and that got repetitive and boring. And that's basically just it. It was battle after battle after battle. And the characters, I don't think they were as good as in the Emperor series. They kind of bled together. It all seemed fairly similar. So I can't make the list because the last, I think it's 3 more books after Genghis died, might be 2. They're just not as good. That's all it is to it. Next in the honorable mention is a nonfiction book. And I don't read nonfiction anymore. I did when I was in school, because that's what they make you do. But this is A Big Little Life by Dean Koontz. And this was the one he actually sent to me. To Travis. Woof. Dean Koontz. So I had to read it, because I mean, he sent me a book. But so I read it. And basically this is just his memoir, kind of himself, but mostly of his dog. But the reason I liked it is because I enjoy autobiographical memoirs that writers do, because they typically do a very good job of writing about themselves. Might be something to do with the fact that we sit in our room by ourselves. And obviously, a writer's memoir is gonna, I'm gonna have something probably, you know, to relate to for some reason that I don't, but yeah. And the story of his dog is touching. He got his first dog when he was like 60. And a lot of the book, he's like, you won't believe what this dog did. I mean, anybody that's had a dog, yeah, you believe it, because dogs are awesome. They're special creatures, Dean. I don't know why you think that we wouldn't believe it, but I did. It's actually one of the few books that I cried at the end because I can really relate to losing my dog and that shit ain't fun. Next honorable mention is The Racketeer by John Grisham. Very mediocre book overall, but it has the best twist I've read in a long, long time. Midway through the book, I did not know what the main character was doing. And I was really like, what is he doing? And I can't spoil it for you, but if you love twists and you like it's not really a legal thriller like his usual stuff, but if you really love twists, check it out. It's a quick, easy read, so yeah. And the final honorable slash dishonorable mention on this one is the Camelot series by Jack White. This is the first book in it. The first 2 books are awesome. It starts 2 generations before Merlin, and I guess 3 generations before Arthur. And it's the founding of Camelot and the Roman withdrawal of Britain, the last days of Roman in there. So it's a lot of historical fiction, and I love historical fiction, so obviously I loved that part. The thing is, though, the first 2 books in the series, they're founding Camelot, and it's awesome, it's interesting. And then the third book comes along, and I think it's just 8 books in the series, might be 7. I'd have to go check, but I'm really not going to, so no, get over it. But the third book comes along, The Eagle Brood. Now, if you'll notice, this is the first book, and this is the third book. And it's quite a bit longer, but a lot more happens in this book than in this book. He got into a really bad habit of having 30 pages worth of dialogue where two characters would talk about very mundane things, and they maybe not completely mundane, but things that don't necessitate 30 pages of dialogue. There's nothing that necessitates 30 pages of dialogue. And it got really old, and it all had the same tone where it's like, good God, man, you sense, think of this, think of that, da-da-da-da-da, on and on. And God, it was awful. I barely got through this book, which is the third book in the series. And he also got where there's a lot of action stuff going on, but he wouldn't show the action. It would just be like, we found a town full of bandits and cleared them by the end of nightfall or whatever. But that would be literally all he'd show of a battle, which ain't cool, dude. You're gonna make me read 30 pages of dialogue. Yeah, I struggled through the third book. About a quarter way through the fourth book, I said screw it, and I put it up, and I haven't read any more of the series. First two books are awesome, like 4 or 5 star worthy. The last of the books, or at least the ones that I have, they're 1 star because I can't finish them, and that's very weird for a series, but I yeah. So now, after much ado, top 5 books that I read in 2013. And at number 5, we have The Hunger Games. Yeah, you've heard of that. I liked the first book a lot. Yes, it doesn't make a lot of sense. If you really stop and think about it, there's a lot that doesn't add up. It's one of those books you read to enjoy it. You don't read to think. As bad as that says, just enjoy it. But the reason it's not higher, and it doesn't even sniff the top 5 books of all time, is because the second book was very meh. And the third book was just awful. The whole book, just Katniss gets injured, passes out, wakes up in a hospital a couple weeks later. Gets injured, wakes up in a hospital a couple weeks later. Rinse and repeat. A whole Revolutionary War takes all of, you know, like 60, 70 pages. And that ain't bueno, dude. So, yeah, that's why that ain't higher. And at 4, we have Odd Thomas by Dean Koontz. It's like The Sixth Sense grown up and goes adventuring. Like, if that kid had turned into a superhero, that... Yeah, ghosts and such. I think you ripped off The Sixth Sense a bit, but I'll forgive you. It's a good book. It's fun. It's fast-paced. The ending is terrible, man. I cried. A good terrible. Like, bawling terrible. I didn't cry a lot. I kind of saw it coming. Oh, well. The movie is out, too. It's not very good, so whatever. Number 3, we have The Cuckoo's Calling by Robert Galbraith, J.K. Rowling, that lady that wrote Harry Potter. Forget about The Casual Vacancy. If you want more, I did a review, so right there, click there. Just wait, click it in the description, and then go see it. Yeah, good stuff. At number 2, we have John Grisham's The Firm. This was his breakout book. He actually sold the film rights before the book, so that's how good it was. Very fast-paced, awesome. I like legal thrillers a lot. If you don't, you might not like it. I do. It's not really a legal thriller, per se. It's more like half legal thriller, half action adventure thriller, so... Fun stuff on that stuff in the sun. Let's move on. And number 1, the second best YA series in history, in my opinion, Artemis Fowl series. Again, there's the whole review. It's right there. Don't click that now. Click it in the description in a minute. Actually, this list is over, so you can click it now if you want to. But I did the whole review there. But awesome, awesome, awesome. The last couple books might not have been as awesome as the first couple, but they're still awesome. So that is my top 5 books that I read in 2013, which I admittedly didn't read a lot of books. I'm sorry. Get over it. I'll give you a hug next time. If you want to see the whole list of what I read, I'll put it in the description. And you know what? Because I love you, I'll go ahead and put a little number off the side in parentheses. That'll tell you how many stars it is that I would give it a rating. That'll be kind of a hackneyed quick job, so I might change it every once in a while. But I'll do that for you because I love you and I haven't been around in a while. Until next time, peace out.
The safety in the numbers of this godforsaken town. It's been a week since all of this went down. This abandoned factory, there's no one here but you and me. God help any fool who comes around.